Hello and welcome in to another online service. So good to have you with us. Thank you for inviting me and for inviting Central into your homes or into your cars or phones or laptops or TVs or whatever device you happen to be watching this off. It's just good to be with you guys in spirit, even if we can't be here in person. And so thank you so much for that. Well, today, I think the first thing we have to do is say that it is Mother's Day. And I know we've already honored mothers, but I just want to say thank you so much to all of the mothers out there. You know, our series topic at the moment is all about heroes. And my goodness me, we all know that mums are heroes anyway. But in a season like this, where they're not only, you know, chef, and they're not only the maid and cleaning the houses and doing dishes, and they're not only, you know, gardening, and they're not only working and providing for families and raising children and nurturing life, now they're also teachers, as though, you know, because the teacher's job is so easy. And I know this is an incredibly stressful season for some of you mothers out there. So just a shout out to all of you right now who have kids, and now you have more kids at home for longer than ever before. Just want to say you guys are the real heroes. No matter who we talk about from the Bible today, my goodness me, you guys are doing just a phenomenal job. And so why don't we just say thank you so much on that chat right now. Come on, let's give them some love. Come on, you can use your fire emoji or your love emoji, hit that like button. We are praying for you and we love you so much. And not only biological mothers, but we also love to celebrate the spirit of motherhood. You know, men and women, we truly believe that they are equal, that they are, that we have this sort of theology of complementarianism is the technical word for it, which basically means that we're equal, but we are good at different things, basically. And we all know that there are just some things women can do that men cannot do and that we are useless at. And so we want to celebrate that today. This is all about celebrating the spirit of motherhood that is on each and every woman's life. And so thank you so much for everything that you do. I know as a son, I'm so grateful to have an incredible mother. She's hilarious, introvert artist, a bit sassy, a little bit cheeky. And I know I wouldn't be half the man I am today without her. And that is true for all of you mothers out there. Thank you so much for just being who you are and for serving your families and for serving your communities in just the incredible, amazing way. We want to see women released into all of the calls and purposes that God has laid out for them. So yes, thank you so much. Oh, I like seeing all the chats going up right now. It's imaginary chats that are popping up in my head. So keep sending the love their way. So we have been covering a whole series on heroes. And for the last 2 weeks, me and Pastor Larry, we've kind of been talking a little bit about Joseph and his life. And I know last week we talked about forgiveness, which can be very emotive for some people. It can be a very difficult thing to let go of some of the past hurts and betrayals and wrongs that people have done. But nevertheless, Jesus calls us to a life of forgiveness. And so we all have to journey and process hurts and pains. And we always want to make sure we're doing that in a healthy way, in a way that's going to bring life to us, not darkness into our world. And so as we move on to talk about heroes today, I will pick up on a couple of specific characters. But really what I wanted to do is I wanted to talk broadly about what makes a hero. And so my sermon topic today is the breakthrough is about to come. And so if you're staring at a device or you're sitting next to a neighbor, can you say that with me? A breakthrough is about to come. And I really believe that for you. I was praying today and whilst I was writing this sermon, God, what is it you want to speak? That there's a whole bunch of people right now who've devoted some time to sit down for the next 25, 30 minutes and to hear something from you. God, what is it you want to speak? And I really felt like this was a word from the Holy Spirit. A breakthrough is about to come. That there's an interesting time in Israel's history, that there's a point in their history where they're taken captive. And there's essentially a new reality that occurs because they get invaded, they get taken captive, they get brought out of their familiarity, they get brought out of their homeland, they get brought out of their language and everything that they know, and they get placed into a new city, in a new town, in a new nation with new rules, new gods, new languages, new food, new etiquette, ways ways of doing life. And they're now there and they're slaves in Babylon. And whilst they're slaves in Babylon, it doesn't take long before lots of different prophets are saying, hey, don't worry, don't worry. God is going to break through. God is going to get us out of this mess. He did it in Egypt, in Exodus. He broke through and he parted the seas and he brought the plagues and we were set free. And God is going to do that again for us. So here's what you need to do. Here's what you need to do. You need to batten down the hatches. You need to hunker down. And we just got to wait this out, because in a year or two, we're going to be home and we're going to be celebrating. But then what happens is there's another prophet that comes along, and this prophet's name is Jeremiah. And in Jeremiah 29, he says, hey, look, what these prophets have been telling you is actually a lie, because God's not going to come and break through in a year or 2 years or 3 years or 10 years or 30 years or 50 years. He says it's going to be 70 years we're going to be captive. And so what we have to do is we have to take hold of this new reality that is occurring. And in fact, he encouraged them. He says, look, plant vineyards, plant gardens, sons and daughters, marry, have children, you know, multiply, be prosperous. And then he finishes the beautiful sort of prophecy by saying, seek peace with the town and with the land, and you will find peace and prosperity. So in other words, he's basically saying, look, this isn't going to be short term, this is going to be long term, but in the midst of trial and persecution, you need to learn to prosper, because God still wants to give you peace and he wants to do something in the midst of this new reality that is not about just taking you back to your old reality. Now, I hope that makes sense. Look, I'm not prophesying that COVID-19 is going to last for the next 70 years and we're going to be stuck in our homes, heaven forbid. But here's what I am saying, that there is a new reality taking place. And there are some new things that we have learned. And God, what he wants to do is he wants to break in and he wants to teach us how to live in peace, and not just live in peace, but actually how to prosper in this reality. And what I've discovered when I read the Bible in life is that every hero pushes through until that breakthrough. They don't stop. They don't say, this is just enough. They have something inside of them, that something is called faith, and their faith comes up against reality and says, no, we're going to push through, but we're not just going to squeeze and with our strength and bear and grin it and hunker down. No, we're actually going to prosper. We're going to enjoy life. And that is the difficulty when reason and faith, they sometimes butt heads and they don't mix, because faith will be unreasonable at times. It will ask the unreasonable thing. Man, that was a good word. If church was filled right now, you'd all be saying amen. I hope you're saying amen at home. Faith will require something that your logic won't be able to piece together in an orderly fashion. Sometimes it requires you to push through. Yes, you may have the diagnosis, I have cancer, but there is a greater truth, there is a greater reality that by his stripes, I am healed, and you can have my body, but you can't have my spirit. You can't have my mind. You can't take away my attitude. And every hero finds a measure of faith that is able to push them through. And I think the sad thing I've often noticed in our culture today is a lot of people will spend their lives pursuing happiness. Did you know happiness is not a virtue? I've never read a scripture in the Bible where it actually says, God just wants you to be happy. I'm not even sure there's a scripture saying, God wants you to be happy. He talks about joy, and I think joy is a fundamentally much deeper, more rooted thing that we have in our lives. It's like a bass note. You know, it's not that treble, but it's like the foundation. Whereas happiness is so much more superficial. And a lot of people are nowadays pursuing, hey, all I want is to be happy in life. And if their partner doesn't make them happy, then it's not going to work. And if their job doesn't make them happy, then it's not going to work. And if they're in a situation where they're not happy, then life is falling apart. And that's the problem when you place all of your trust in this one word, happiness. But here's the problem with only pursuing happiness. Are you ready for this? You can be doing extremely selfish and sinful things and be happy about it. That's why you can't just pursue happiness, because you can be incredibly selfish and be happy about it. You can do unbelievably hateful and mean things and be joyful about it. And so God is wanting to put something so much more fundamentally deeper in you. He doesn't want you to just to live a happy life. He wants you to live a faith life, because happiness is not going to break you through your situation. Happiness isn't going to cure you of your diseases. Happiness isn't going to find you a new job when you need it. Happiness isn't going to kickstart that business for you, but faith will. And ultimately, when we live a life of faith, what we do is we step into God's purpose, we step into His destiny. And it's sad when I see young people only pursue happiness, because what I tend to find is those who only pursue happiness, they have no purpose. They have no direction in life. So it's one thing when a young person does that. It's even sadder when you have middle-aged and elderly people and all they're looking for is something comfortable. And I just don't believe it's biblical or it's true in reality that God wants to give you a comfortable life. I think He wants to give you a good life. I think He wants you to be fulfilled and to find joy. But my understanding of heroes when they engage with God is that He is wanting you to press through some real difficulties, because at the end of the day, it's trials and tribulations that are going to produce perseverance, and perseverance so that you can become fully mature and able to do all of the good works that God has called us to. That's a quote from 1 James. So happiness is not a virtue and something that we should pursue. And so what does it mean to be a hero? You know, there's lots of, I was thinking about it today, what does it really mean? You know, there's lots of attributes we could talk about. We could talk about their selflessness. We could talk about their bravery. And I like actually what Emerson says. I found a quote and he says that we love heroes. Oh, sorry, I'm reading the wrong thing here. He says that heroes are basically normal people, but they're just normal people that are braver for 5 minutes longer. They're just normal people that are able to stand in faith for 5 minutes longer than anybody else. In other words, when difficulties come up, when struggles come up, they have some substance to them. And so today I really want to talk about what is that substance. And so to do that, here is a true life story. Now, some of you will know West Point, which is a very prestigious military school in the United States. Now, this school is really, really difficult to get into. Incredibly. Now, Harvard is difficult, Yale is difficult, but this school is even harder to get into. Like, you actually need a letter of recommendation from a member of Congress or the vice president just to be considered. Not only do you have to have the same grades as places like Harvard or Yale, but you also need to have the physical attributes. So you have to be able to do sit-ups and pull-ups, you have to be able to run at a certain speed. So you have to be physically fit. You have to have high SAT scores. You have to be connected so that you can be nominated to even get a shot at maybe being considered. Now at West Point, here's what they do, is of all of the people apply, they roughly get about 6,000 applications per year. So 6,000 people qualify to meet their criteria. Then from 6,000 people, they take the top 2,500 of them. And then from 2,500, they interview all of them and they whittle it down to only accepting about 1,200 students a year. Now, here's the problem they were having. They had really strict criteria about how to get into the school. Physical fitness, intelligence, connections. And they whittled it down to getting the best of the best of the best. These 1,200 are intelligent. They're physically fit. They're strong. They have a sharpness about them. They have leadership skills. These are the captains of the football team. These are the types of people that you want on your team. So 1,200 of the best from the whole of the United States. Here's the problem they were having, is that within 2 months, 20% of their students would drop out. So even though they had a really high criteria for accepting people in, 20% of all students would drop out. So they spend 2 years trying to get into this school. And then after 2 months, 1 in 5 says, I'm done, I can't do it, it's too much. Now this was a problem for West Point, because they couldn't figure out why they weren't picking the students that were gonna make the cut or push through. And so in comes a very intelligent woman called Angela Duckworth. And she writes about this in her book called Grit. And what she did was she came up with a test called the Grit Test, which was basically a way to measure, does this person have grit? Not are they intelligent, not do they have a high IQ score, not are they well-connected or rich or wealthy or leadership skills or potential, not were they talented, not could they play five instruments. None of that mattered. She basically came up with a method for measuring whether students had some grit. In other words, were they going to stick it out when times got tough? Now, she implemented this, and as soon as they implemented it, it dropped from over 240 students dropping out within 2 months to only 65 students dropping out after the entire year. And even then, she was able to predict that those 65 were going to be the most likely to drop out. In other words, what does this all show? It shows that to have some kind of success in life, to move forward in life, to progress, to accomplish your dreams and your goals, you've got to have something about you that says, I'm not going to give up. I'm not gonna melt down as soon as adversity comes, but I'm gonna have some moral fiber in my life. I'm gonna have some substance to the core of who I am that is gonna push through my failings and my pain and my hurt and my sorrow and my embarrassment and that betrayal that happened to me, that I'm not gonna sit here in the pit wallowing in my own misery, but I'm actually going to pursue God because I have a calling and I have a purpose and I know that that is the truth on which I stand. And so that's just my encouragement to you straight off the bat. Please develop some grit in your life. That's the beautiful thing. You're not born with it. Some people are born with talent. Some people are born with a high IQ. Grit, you don't have to be born with it. You can develop it in your life, just like you can develop wisdom in your life. So there are situations you can be in and you can make a choice to say, no, I'm gonna be somebody of courage who's gonna sit in. I'm gonna be the hero of my own story. When I look at the Bible, I find that there are a lot of heroes that I could pull out. And I was struggling to figure out who should I talk about. And then I kind of thought, you know, I thought about David and Goliath, and that's obviously a great story that we love to talk about. You know, little guy takes on the big guy and wins. Everyone loves that story. And I thought about a number of things, but then I was thinking more about it. And I just thought that when it comes to being a hero, really what defines you more than your deeds of greatness is your failures and your ability to keep moving, your ability to break through even when you mess up. Every single hero in the Bible, they were a mess. There's no other way to describe it. They were an absolute mess. Noah gets drunk and ends up walking around the vineyards and at some point in the night takes off his clothes and so he's in the nuddy and then his sons find him naked, you know, lying face down in his birthday suit. This is Noah. This isn't before he does all the good stuff. This is after he'd accomplished everything, after God had moved, after he'd seen all the promises. He was a mess. You have Jacob. He deceives his mother. He deceives his father with his mother's help. He lies, and he lies by omission. Have you ever done that? Have you ever lied by omission? And you've convinced yourself that you weren't lying just because you didn't say anything? He was a liar, and ultimately he reaped what he sowed. He got deceived as well. Moses was a premeditated murderer. I looked to the left, I looked to the right, seeing that there was nobody there. I struck the Egyptian. He thought about it, and seeing that he could get away with it, he killed him. He buried the guy, but unfortunately there's a lot of sand in Egypt. The sand moves away, and you know there's a leg sticking out, and they figure out it was Moses. He's a murderer. Not only that, he did something that God told him deliberately, specifically not to do. He struck the rock twice. You know, mums are at home right now with their kids. You know, when you're telling your kid, don't you dare, don't you dare. And then they do it. And you're like, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to murder you. That's exactly what it's like with Moses, like deliberately disobeying God. He was a murderer. King Saul was so insecure that he tried to kill all of the talented people around him. He hired 2,000 mercenaries to pursue David, who had done nothing wrong. And then on top of that, he seeks the advice of witches, basically. He stopped seeking the voice of God. David was an adulterous killer who, at the end of his life, he's sitting on his deathbed talking to his son Solomon, and he gives him a hit list. Kill him, kill him, kill him. This will set up your kingdom. Solomon, he had 700 wives and 300 concubines. Are you kidding me? 1,000 women? I mean, that's enough to keep any man busy. That's like 3,000 personalities. Sorry, I shouldn't have said that. Not only that, he reinstitutes slave labor. He forgets where his people are from. He forgets that his people have been brought out of slavery. And by the time you get to Solomon, what is he doing? He's building chariots again. Well, what does chariots remind you of? It reminds you of Egypt. And he begins to enforce slave labor to build the temple and to build buildings. Well, what does that remind you of? Egypt. He forgets the story of his own people and becomes the oppressor of the Israelites again, lording over them. Peter denies Christ 3 times. I don't know that man. I don't know that man. I've never seen him before in my life. There he is. There's Jesus giving his life for the very sin that Peter is committing in front of his face. I don't know that man. Paul hunted Christians, brought them in front of judges. Paul defines himself in 1 Timothy as the chief of sinners, the greatest of all sinners. James, Jesus' own brother, didn't believe in his ministry, didn't believe that what he was doing was legitimate, was undercutting Jesus. He felt that Jesus should have stayed home and taken care of the family when Joseph died. It was Jesus' responsibility. He was the oldest son. Now he was just gallivanting off, claiming that he's the new Messiah. He thought that Jesus was a phony. It was not until Jesus came back and was resurrected from the dead that he was finally bought in to who Jesus was. Look at all of these heroes. Do you know what I see? I see broken, dysfunctional, needy, insecure, reactionary men, but they were all heroes. And they were heroes simply because of one thing: they would not give up. That when they messed up, they kept coming back to God. They were heroes of the faith, and they carried on this tradition because when adversity met them, they weren't happy just to sit back and to write a country and western album about how depressed they were, which is what we all want to do when we're depressed. Let me finish with a quick story. And this is a bit of an obscure story from 1 Kings. And it's 1 Kings 18, 43. And this is Elijah. And Elijah at this time, he's just confronted the prophets of Baal. And do you remember he calls down fire and he pours water on the altar and the fire comes down and everything burns up. And he has this incredible victory. And straight after this, he's at Mount Carmel and there's been a famine in the land. So there's been basically no rain and no water. And he prophesies that it will come and he's waiting for the promise. And some of you, you're waiting right now for the promise of God, for him to do something for you. And so this is what happens, just a very short segment here. He says, go and look toward the sea. He's talking to his servant and he says, hey, go and look towards the sea. So his servant, he gets up and he climbs up Mount Carmel and he looked out. There is nothing there. So he comes back and he says, there's nothing there. 7 times Elijah says, go back. The 7th time, he reported, a cloud as small as a man's hand is rising up from the sea. Now, we often read past that story. I think it's funny, sometimes the Bible doesn't give you those details. But just imagine for a second this servant, what he's going through. So they're at the bottom of the mountain. And here's Elijah. And he says, hey, go up the mountain, see if you can find a cloud, right? And so the guy goes, yeah, cool. Yeah, no problem. And so he's up the mountain, whoo, whoo, at the top, I finally made it all the way around, sweating, got there, and he's at the top. He's looking out. Okay, cloud, looking for a cloud. Whew, looking for a cloud. Okay, no, there's no cloud. Okay, back down. Here we go. No, he gets all the way back down. He's running. There's a trail. Gets down. Elijah, I did it. I got to the top. All right, there's nothing there. There's nothing at the top. Elijah, oh, okay. Can you go again and have a look? Again? Yeah. Sure, okay. Okay, yeah. We'll go. Okay. Here we go. Woo! Second time up the mountain. Here we go. Woo! Coming up the mountain. Here we go. To the top. There we go. Looking out for the cloud. Can I see a cloud? Is there a cloud? Cloud? No cloud. Right. Okay. That's okay. Maybe it's coming later. I'll come down the mountain. Down the trail. Hey, Elisha. Hey, there's no cloud. I had a look. I went up there. I had a look. There's no cloud. Do you mind going up again? The cloud's coming. I know it's coming. Yeah. All right. Yeah, I'll go up the mountain again. All right. Up the mountain again. That's number three. Here we go. I mean, we can pretty much see from the bottom what we can see at the top. I don't know. But here we are. Is there a cloud here? No cloud. What a surprise. Okay. Here we go. Nope. No, Elijah. There's no cloud. I've looked three times now. There's no cloud. But, you know, I was a good servant, good and faithful servant. You are welcome. I'm going to take a little breather. Do you mind going up again? Just have a look, see if there's another cloud. Really? I was going to... Sure. This guy's an idiot. Right, fourth time. Yeah, no, there's no... Yeah, exactly what I thought. There's no cloud. If he asked me to go up one more time. Hey, yeah, there's no, I've looked, I'm beat. I'm going to take a little rest. Can you go up one more time? This guy, who does he think he is? Who does he think he is? I'm walking up the mountain. I'm going up. I don't know how many times now. Like, what is he going to accomplish? Yeah, no, what a surprise. Nothing. Once again. That's right. Nothing once again. This guy Elijah, I thought he's meant to be the prophet. I thought he's meant to know what's going on. I don't know how many times I've been up there. Yeah, no, nothing. What a surprise. Can you go out one more time? I could do that two more times, but I think you get the point. Sometimes God will ask you to do something again. And it's because He's still waiting for you to learn the lesson that you didn't learn the first time. Because there is a promise that you were given when you were young. There was a promise, there was a destiny, there was a purpose, there was a dream that was put inside of your heart. And somehow through the process of life, through losing, through failing, through getting beaten down, through getting trodden on, through being jaded, you've looked at life and you've said, I've been up that mountain before, I've had a lookout, and there's no cloud coming. And here's the thing that people say to me all the time, insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. No, that's not true. Insanity is doing nothing and expecting God to move. Sometimes you have to hit the tree with the axe more than one time before the tree is going to fall. And some of you, you've given up on your dreams. And what I want to say to you, if you want to be the hero of your own story, is reawaken that dream. Don't give up on what God wants to do in your life. Don't give up on the promise that He laid before you. Don't give up on the things that He wants to accomplish through you for the glory of God and for the glory of the church. You've been so jaded and broken and beaten down, and now you're just kind of walking around. And then what we do is we find other people who are jaded. Couples do it all the time. We get couples angry. You know, when couples, they get angry together. That's the thing couples like to do. And God, He's wanting to come in. He's wanting to break through, and He's saying, look, I know you've done it six times. Will you go up one more time? Because there is a breakthrough that is about to happen. That healing is about to come through for you. You just need to have faith that that job is about to break through in your life. You need to have faith. And I know reason says I've walked up there a bunch of times. It doesn't work. It will work. It will work because God He wants to do something incredible in your life. I've experienced this so many times in my life. And there are times where I've walked around and around and around and I've just thought, God, what are you trying to teach me? Well, he's trying to teach you perseverance so that you can be fully mature and so that you can accomplish every good work that God has called you to. And I just want to say to you, for those of you who are a little bit cynical and a little bit broken, come on. I want to encourage you one more time. Will you walk up that mountain? Will you take a look out? Because the seventh time he gets up there and he says it's no bigger than the size of his hand. It looks like a tiny, no bigger than the size of a man's hand. I think that's a cloud. I think that's the promise. I think that's the rain. I think that's God about to pour out his spirit here in this moment. I think he's about to accomplish something in your life. Look, if you're not in a group, can I encourage you, please get into a group. You need people around you who are going to support you, who are going to lift you up. And here's a couple, five very quick questions for you. Number one, my first question is, what did you give up on? What did you give up on? Or maybe question number two, maybe you didn't give up on something, but maybe you gave up on someone. Who did you give up on? What dream needs to be reawakened? What promise needs to be reclaimed? What well needs to be redug in your life? Question number three, what challenges are you facing right now that you know you need help persevering through? And who can you ask for help? Question number four, has failure ever set you back? Is failure right now setting you back? And how can you push through it? And then number five, would you be open to asking the Holy Spirit to reawaken desire, to reawaken passion, enthusiasm? Because I really believe that if you're going to be the hero of your own story, you've got to break through some things in your life. You've got to break through some spiritual heritage things that have been passed down to you. You've got to break through some bad habits. You've got to break through some trials and tribulations. But I think the promise is coming. So Father God, if you would, just right now, if that was a good word, feel free to write amen in the chat there. Feel free to share this. But just right now, wherever you are, would you close your eyes and just, you can open up your hands like this as though you're about to receive something, or if that's you, you can put up your hand like that. But just take a moment right now where there's no distractions around you, where you're not moving, but just take a moment with the Holy Spirit. Father God, would you be with us? Would you speak to us? Lord, in the areas of my life where I've given up, where I've lacked grit in my life, where I've become cynical and where I've become jaded, where I've begun to roll my eyes more often, Father, would you begin to soften my heart? Lord, would you begin to do a new work inside of me? Would you begin to break through again, Father God? Would you give me the strength and the perseverance to go up that mountain one more time and to look out for your promise, Father God, to look out for the things that you want to accomplish? And so in Jesus' name, I just pray right now, I release something in the supernatural over people's lives as they stretch out their heart and they stretch out their hand to you, Father God, that there would be a breakthrough, that there would be a new faith that is stirred inside of their lives. And so in Jesus' name, we all said, amen. Amen. Well, have a fantastic week. And I encourage you once again, get into a group. We will be discussing this more as we go along throughout the week and talking more about heroes. Make sure you spoil mothers today. Treat them to something nice. God bless Central. Have a fantastic week. Take care.